Welcome students. So today in neuroanatomy, today we will do the external features of the medulla oblongata and some internal features also at the lower part of the medulla oblongata. External features of the medulla oblongata. First of all, it develops from the myelin cephalon, that is lower part of the hind brain. And it is connected to the pons rostrally and to the spinal cord caudally. It has conical shape, that is, it is broader superiorly. Now, the junction between the spinal cord and the medulla is at the origin of the first cervical spinal nerve. This is almost the level of foramen magnum. And the central canal of the spinal cord continues to the lower part of the medulla. The medulla is divided into two parts based on the presence of fourth ventricle, into the caudal closed part and rostral open part. Now, as in the spinal cord, there is the anterior median fissure on the anterior surface of the medulla. Now, lateral to this anterior median fissure lies the medullary pyramids. I will show you in the diagram. Now, lateral to these medullary pyramids lie the medullary olives. They are produced by the medullary olive bulge is produced by the inferior olivary nuclei. The inferior cerebellar peduncles lies posterior to the olives. So this is the anterior features of the anterior surface of the medulla oblongata. Now, posterior median sulcus lies in the spinal cord. The posterior median sulcus lies in the posterior part of the caudal medulla. Lateral to the posterior median sulcus in the caudal medulla, there are tubercles, known as gracile and cuneate tubercle. And these tubercles are produced by the gracile and cuneate nuclei, underlying gracile and cuneate nuclei respectively. Now, here you can see that the medulla oblongata here. This is the medulla oblongata. This is the medulla oblongata, this is the pons, and this is the midbrain. So this is the part of brain stem. Posterior to the medulla oblongata lies the cerebellar hemispheres. Now this medulla oblongata is continuous with the spinal cord below, and above it is continuous with the pons. Now, as I have told you, it extends from the foramen magnum to the level of the atlas vertebrae. And this medulla is has got vital functions. Now, the lower end of the, as I have told you before, the lower end which contains the upward continuation of the central canal is known as closed part of the medulla. Here you can see the upward continuation of the central canal. Now, this is the open part of the medulla. The upper end where the canal comes to the surface as the lower part of the floor of fourth ventricle is the open part. So, medulla is divided into two parts, closed part and open part. The picture you can see in this slide, you can see the anterior surface of the brain stem and the spinal cord. So this is the pons, you can see here superiorly, this is the pons and this is the medulla. So this is the medulla oblongata, and below medulla it is continuous with the spinal cord. Now, the anterior median fissure, as I have told you, so this anterior median fissure, it is continuous from the spinal cord to the level of the medulla oblongata, anterior median fissure. Lateral to the anterior median fissure are the bulges, which are known as pyramid. And these pyramids contain the corticospinal fibers. Now, in the lower part of the medulla, these fibers decussate here. So, this is known as decussation of pyramids. Now, lateral to the pyramids lie the bulge, which is known as olives. Now, these olives are produced due to the underlying olivary nucleus. And lateral to the olivary olives lies the inferior cerebellar peduncle here. So, here you can see some of the nerves emerging from the anterior surface of the medulla. Now, between the pyramid and the pons emerges the abducens nerve. Between the pyramid and the pons emerges the abducens nerve. And then between the olives and the pons emerges the motor root and the sensory root of the facial nerve. Here you can see. Then more laterally emerges the vestibulocochlear nerve, the eighth cranial nerve. And then from the sides of the olive emerges the glossopharyngeal, vagus, and then accessory nerve. Glossopharyngeal, vagus, and accessory nerve. The hypoglossal nerve, it emerges from the junction between the pyramid and the olives by, and you can see here that they are emerging by rootlets, various rootlets, and then these rootlets join to form single nerve. So this is the anterior surface of the medulla oblongata. The posterior surface of the medulla oblongata. The posterior surface of the superior half of medulla oblongata forms the lower part of the floor of the fourth ventricle. So here you can see this is the floor, lower part of the, this all is the fourth ventricle. Now this is the lower part of the fourth ventricle, which forms the upper part of the posterior surface of the medulla oblongata. Now, the posterior surface of inferior half of medulla is continuous with the posterior aspect of spinal cord and possesses the posterior median sulcus. So, here you can see this is the posterior median sulcus. On each side of the median sulcus, there is elongated swelling known as gracile tubercle produced by the underlying gracile nucleus. So this is the gracile tubercle, and this is produced by the underlying gracile nucleus. Lateral to the gracile tubercle is a similar swelling, which is known as the cuneate tubercle. So cuneate tubercle, the lateral one, cuneate tubercle. Produced by the underlying cuneate nucleus. So this the structures present in the fourth ventricle, the floor of the fourth ventricle, we will do it along the fourth ventricle. But to tell you here, the dorsally, the lower part of the floor of the fourth ventricle forms the upper part of the medulla, and here the roof of the ventricle is the ependyma and the pia mater. So on this part here, the roof is only the ependyma and the pia mater. At the lower corner of the diamond shaped floor, this is the diamond shaped floor, and lower in the lower corner, the hypoglossal trigone is adjacent to the midline. So this is the hypoglossal trigone. It is adjacent to the midline with the vagal trigone lateral to it. So this is the vagal trigone here, vagal trigone. This is the hypoglossal trigone and this is the vagal trigone. And higher up and at the lower lateral corners of the diamond is the vestibular area. So this is the vestibular area. In the lower part or closed part of the medulla, the fourth ventricle has become narrowed to the tiny central canal, and external dorsal surface shows small elevations, the gracile and cuneate tubercles. Internal structure of the medulla oblongata. As in spinal cord, the medulla oblongata also consists of white matter and the gray matter. But a study of transverse section of this region shows that they have been extensively rearranged. Now, first of all, we will do the white matter and the gray matter. The closed part of the medulla oblongata, it contains the spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve, spinal accessory nucleus, nucleus gracilis and nucleus cuneatus. White matter, motor fibers and sensory fibers. Motor fibers, the pyramidal decussation, and sensory fibers, the sensory tract of trigeminal nerve, the lateral spinothalamic tract, anterior and posterior spinocerebellar tract, internal arcuate fibers, and medial lemniscus, beginning of medial lemniscus in the closed part of medulla oblongata. Spinal cord, the medulla oblongata consists of white matter and the gray matter. And the internal structure of medulla oblongata is considered at four levels. Number one level is the level of decussation of the pyramids. Number two, at the level of decussation of lemnisci. Number three, at the level of olives. And number four, at the level just inferior to the pons. So we will see the major structures present at each level. Now the section at the level of pyramidal decussation, as shown in this slide, has some similarities to the section of the spinal cord. So I will draw the section of spinal cord here so you can differentiate it like that. This is the gray matter, central canal. This is the anterior white column, lateral white column, posterior white column. This is the posterior gray matter, anterior gray matter, central gray matter, and this is here the lateral gray horns in some segments of the spinal cord. So this part of the medulla oblongata has got some similarities with the structure of the spinal cord. And the central canal is surrounded by the central gray matter. Here you can see this is the central canal, and it is surrounded by the central gray matter. The ventral gray columns are present but are separated from the central gray matter by decussating pyramidal fibers. Now here in the spinal cord, the gray matter is continuous with the central gray matter. The anterior horns are continuous with the central gray matter. While here in the medulla, this is the ventral gray matter, and it is separated from the central gray matter by the decussating fibers of the pyramid or the corticospinal tracts. The region behind the central gray matter is occupied by the fasciculus gracilis medially and fasciculus cuneatus laterally. So, fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus. Now, closely related to these fasciculi are two tongue-shaped extensions of the central gray matter. So, this was the central gray matter, and these are the tongue-shaped extensions of the central gray matter. And medially lies the nucleus gracilis, and laterally lies the nucleus cuneatus. And posterior to that lies the fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus. More laterally, there is the spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve. So here you can see more, this was the central gray matter and this is the extension of the central gray matter, tongue shaped extension of the central gray matter, and posterior to these tongue shaped structures lie the fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus, and these tongue shaped extension of the central gray matter of the medulla oblongata, it consists of nucleus gracilis and nucleus cuneatus. Now, lateral to these structures lie the trigeminal nerve nucleus. When traced inferiorly, this nucleus reaches the second cervical segment of the spinal cord, where it becomes continuous with the substantia gelatinosa. So, this spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve is the extension of substantia gelatinosa cells. And this extends up to the cervical 2 level, second cervical segment level. Above the nucleus extends as far as the upper part of the pons. The spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve is related superficially to the spinal tract of the nerve. Now this is the surface of the medulla oblongata and this is the spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve. The ventral part of the medulla is occupied on either side of the midline by the prominent bundle of fibers. These fibers form the pyramid. Now here in the ventral part of the medulla oblongata lies the structures known as pyramid, and these pyramids are occupied by the corticospinal fibers. These fibers are on their way from the cerebral cortex to the spinal cord. At this level in the medulla, many of these fibers run backwards and medially. So they are running backwards and medially. Here you can see they are running backwards and medially. And they cross in the midline. These crossing fibers constitute the decussation of the pyramid. Having crossed the midline, the corticospinal fibers run downwards to enter the lateral wide column of the spinal cord. The anterolateral region of medulla is continuous with the anterior and lateral panniculi of the spinal cord. So, in the anterolateral part of the medulla, there are the same white matter, that is the anterior spinocerebellar tract, posterior spinocerebellar tract, and lateral spinothalamic tracts. Section at the level of pyramidal decussation. Some additional points in this diagram. You can see the study first of all the, I will show you again the same features. This is the central gray matter, central canal, and you can see tongue-like extension of central gray matter, that is nucleus cuneatus and nucleus gracilis, and posterior to that is the fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus, and then the lateral part. In the lateral part lies the nucleus of trigeminal nerve and spinal tract of trigeminal nerve. Here you can see on the, between the surface of the medulla oblongata and the nucleus of the trigeminal nerve lies the spinal tract of trigeminal nerve. And here you can see the central gray matter is separated from the ventral gray column by the decussating fibers of the corticospinal tract. So this is the pyramid, and fibers from here, they goes medially and dorsally, and they decussate and then they descend in the spinal cord as the lateral corticospinal tract. This is the ventral gray column, and this column is the neurons in it give origin to the uppermost rootlets of the first cervical nerve and to some fibers in the spinal root of the accessory nerve. Now, the area between the ventral gray column and the spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve is occupied by the lower part of the reticular formation. So, here lies the reticular formation. So, I will tell you brief about the reticular formation. Now, the main descending pathways and ascending pathways, and then the rest of the tracts are also present in this lower part of the medulla. The main descending fibers to be seen at this level are the, as I have told you before, the corticospinal fibers that form the pyramids. After crossing the midline, these fibers run down in the region lateral to the central gray matter to form the lateral corticospinal tracts. This is the lateral corticospinal tract. And some of the fibers do not cross. Some of the fibers in the pyramid, they do not cross and they descend into the ventral funiculus of the spinal cord to form the ventral corticospinal tracts. Now, other descending tracts to be seen at this level in the anterolateral part of medulla are the rubrospinal tracts, vestibulospinal tracts, olivospinal tracts, and tectospinal tracts. These are all the descending tracts which have to pass through the medulla in order to reach the spinal cord. The tectospinal tract is incorporated within the medial longitudinal fasciculus. Among descending tracts, we may also include the spinal tract of trigeminal nerve, which forms a layer of fibers superficial to the spinal nucleus of this nerve, as I have told you before. The ascending tracts to be seen at this level, as I have told you, the fasciculus gracilis, fasciculus cuneatus, which occupy the area between the corresponding nuclei, where these are the fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus. And the spinothalamic, spinocerebellar, spinotectal, and spinoolivary tracts that occupy the anterolateral region. Now, all these tracts are the ascending tracts have to cross through the medulla in order to reach these destinations from the spinal cord. Spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve, it extends, as I have told you, it extends from the pons to the cervical 2 level, and they carry these nuclei, they receive the pain, temperature, and crude touch from the ipsilateral head and neck part. And they usually perceive the general somatic sensations. And they have connection with the sixth, seventh and ninth and tenth cranial nerves. Now, spinal accessory nucleus, only nuclei of the spinal accessory nerve, and it reaches the lower medullary levels from the spinal cord. Gracile nuclei, gracile and cuneate nuclei. The gracile and cuneate nuclei underlie the corresponding tubercles of the dorsal surface of the lower part of medulla, and they contain the cell bodies on which the incoming fibers of gracile and cuneate tracts of the spinal cord terminate. The nerve gives origin to the medial lemniscus. So the nuclei, it gives origin to the medial fibers, which are known as medial lemniscus. We will discuss it. This is the next level, the transverse section of medulla oblongata at the level of decussation of the medial lemnisci. And this is somewhat higher level, section through medulla at somewhat higher level. The central canal surrounded by central gray matter. Here you can see the central canal. and it is surrounded by the central gray matter. The nucleus gracilis, nucleus cuneatus, nucleus gracilis and nucleus cuneatus. Here you can see nucleus cuneatus. The spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve and the track of the spinal nucleus and the pyramids, they occupy the same position as at the lower levels. The nucleus gracilis and nucleus cuneatus are, however, much larger and are no longer continuous with the central gray matter. You can see here, they are much larger as compared to the previous section, and they are no longer continuous with the central gray matter. The fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus are less prominent. So, fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus, they are less prominent here, and the region just behind the pyramid is occupied by prominent bundle of fibers, the medial lemniscus. So, the medial lemnisci are present in the here, just behind the here. Medial lemnisci should be present here, not shown in this picture. The medial lemnisci. Medial lemnisci. Okay. Now, it is present on either side of the midline. The medial lemniscus is formed by fibers arising in the nucleus gracilis. So, you can see here, these fibers are arising from the nucleus gracilis and the nucleus cuneatus. And these fibers cross the midline, turns upwards in the lemniscus of the opposite side. So, they cross the midline to the lemniscus of the opposite side and then turn upwards. In the lemniscus of the opposite side, the crossing fibers of these of the two sides constitute the sensory decussation. So this is also known as the crossing fibers are also known as sensory decussation. The region lateral to the medial lemniscus contains scattered neurons mixed with nerve fibers. This region is reticular formation. So here is the reticular formation. Is lying reticular formation. More laterally, there is a mass of white matter containing various tracts. So laterally, the mass of white matter containing various tracts. So a little bit portion of the inferior olivary nucleus is also visible at this section. Okay, then the ascending and descending tracts at this level of the medulla. The level represented by this section, as I have told you, lies a little above the level of pyramidal decussation. Some features of a section at this level have already I have told you. And the central canal surrounded by central gray matter, the medial lemniscus, the pyramids, the nucleus gracilis, nucleus cuneatus, spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve and the reticular formation, I have told you all. The nucleus gracilis and nucleus cuneatus are much larger than the lower levels and internal arcuate fibers. Now, these fibers which are arising from these nuclei, fasciculus cuneatus and fasciculus gracilis, these fibers arising and crossing to the midline, through the central gray matter, these crossing fibers constitutes the lemniscal or sensory decussation, and these fibers are known as internal arcuate fibers. The fibers arising from these nuclei, they are known as internal arcuate fibers, and they form the sensory or lemniscal decussation. Having crossed the midline, these fibers turn cranially to constitute the medial lemniscus. As the fibers forms the nucleus gracilis and nucleus cunctatus pass forwards, they cross each other so that the fibers from the nucleus gracilis come to lie ventral to those from the nucleus cunctatus. So fibers of the nucleus gracilis, they come to lie ventrally, and cunctatus fibers, they lie posteriorly. So lamination is also present in this tract. The most medial fibers from the legs come to lie most anteriorly in the medial lemniscus. So in the medial lemniscus, most anterior fibers are from the leg area, and these are followed by fibers from the trunk, then from upper limb. In that order, higher up in the brainstem, the medial lemniscus changes its orientation. Its long axis, as you can see here, becomes transverse. I will show you in the next coming levels. The most anterior fibers become lateral fibers, that is the leg area, it becomes laterally, and the posterior fibers become medial. And in its course through the medulla, the medial lemniscus is joined by the anterior spinothalamic tract. Now the fibers in the medial lemniscus are arranged in layers corresponding to the spinal segments. The fibers from segment C1 are most medial, and those from the S4 are most lateral. So lamination of this medial lemnisci also occurs. Accessory cuneate nucleus is placed dorsolateral to the cuneate nuclei. It is not shown in this picture. Accessory cuneate nucleus, it receives proprioceptive impulses from the upper limb through fibers arising in the spinal gray matter of cervical segments of the cord. Efferents of this accessory cuneate nucleus constitutes the posterior external arcuate fibers. They reach the cerebellum through the inferior cerebellar peduncle of the same side. A number of cranial nerve nuclei can be identified at this level. Several of these are present in relation to the central gray matter. The hypoglossal nucleus is located ventral to the central canal, just lateral to the midline. So this is the hypoglossal nucleus. This one hypoglossal nucleus just ventral to the central canal. Hypoglossal nucleus is lying just ventral to the central canal. The lower ends of these nuclei of the two sides become continuous with each other to form the commissural nucleus of the vagus nerve. Now the nucleus of the solitary tract is seen dorsal to the central canal near the midline. So ventral to the midline are the hypoglossal nucleus, and dorsal to the midline lies the nuclei of the tractus solitarius, solitary tract, and the lower end of these nuclei of the two sides, they become continuous with each other to form the commissural nucleus of the vagus. The nucleus ambiguus lies in the reticular formation here. You can see the nucleus ambiguus of the vagus nerve and medial to the spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve. So this is the nucleus ambiguus. Other masses of gray matter that may be recognized at this level is the inferior olivary nucleus, lowest part of the inferior olivary nucleus. You can see here, lowest part of the inferior olivary nucleus, and medial accessory olivary nucleus, which lie dorsal to the medial part of inferior olivary nucleus. The lateral reticular nucleus lying in the lateral part of the reticular formation, and arcuate nuclei lying on the anterior aspect of the pyramid. So here lies the arcuate nuclei on the anterior aspect of the pyramid. So here lies the arcuate nuclei. The descending tracts present are the pyramids, the rubrospinal, the vestibulospinal, the oligospinal tracts, the medial longitudinal fasciculus, which includes the tectospinal tract. And the ascending tracts to be seen at this level are the spinothalamic tracts, spinocerebellar, spinotectal, and spinoolivary tracts, all of which lie in the anterolateral region here, anterolateral region. So again, a more detailed section at this level, that is the sensory decussation. Now you can see here the nucleus gracilis and nucleus cunatus, they are much larger and they are separated from the central gray matter, and the fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cunatus are much smaller here. Then the central gray matter, you can see the central canal and the central gray matter. Ventral to the central gray matter lies the hypoglossal nuclei, and lateral to the central gray matter lies the dorsal nucleus of vagus. And here in the reticular formation lies the nucleus ambiguus. So posterior to the central gray matter lies the nucleus of solitary tract. Now in the lateral anterior part, you can appreciate the pyramids and the anterior arcuate nuclei anterior to the pyramids. Now from these nucleus cunatus and nucleus gracilis arise fibers which are known as internal arcuate fibers, and these fibers, they cross the midline and they end in a structure known as medial lemniscus. They ascend, after crossing they ascend and they form a tract which is known as medial lemniscus. The fibers from the nucleus gracilis and nucleus cunatus, the fibers of the nucleus gracilis, they lie anteriorly, ventrally, while fibers of the nucleus cunatus lie posteriorly. This medial lemniscus then ascends from the high levels of the medulla oblongata. Now in the lateral part lies the spinal tract of trigeminal nerve, and the trigeminal nerve and the nucleus of the spinal tract of trigeminal nerve. Now the descending and anterolateral white matter, other tracts, ascending tracts and descending tracts, as I have shown you, as I have told you before, and the lower parts of the inferior olivary nuclei and the medial accessory olivary nuclei.